It's night one of the 2018 FHSAA Football State Championships. Tonight, live streaming here on Spectrum Sports, it's the 4A Championship game, a rematch of last year's final. The 10-3 Cocoa Tigers taking on the 12-1 Reigns Vikings from Camping World Stadium in downtown Orlando. Here's a look at how each of these teams got to tonight's championship game. Reigns dominant in the postseason, shutting out both West Nassau and then Dunellen in the state semifinals. Cocoa defeated Bishop Vero in the region final, and then a thriller last week as the Tigers rallied from a 31-17 deficit to defeat University School from Fort Lauderdale. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Orlando. Austin Lyon, Jeff Carlson, thank you so much for joining us. These teams played in a thrilling state final a year ago, Reigns winning 13-10 for their second title. A hungry Cocoa team arrives here at Camping World Stadium looking for some revenge.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that's what they play for. But just to get back, what a challenge to get back here and to have the 16 champion and the 17 champion going at it for the 18 champion. It should be fun. It should be a very quality matchup, both sides. We don't always get that in the state championship, but I think we're going to get it here.
This one of the more highly anticipated matchups of the weekend. Dynamic athletes on both of these rosters. For Cocoa, Willie Gaines, a phenomenal year both running and catching.
Well, and Coach Snyder said that this is basically the best all-around athlete that he's ever seen. Yeah. And it's because size, speed, athleticism, we're going to see him be a impact player on both sides of the ball, probably play more on defense than we have seen him all season long.
And in the backfield for Reigns, the school's all-time leading rusher, Brandon Marshall, more than 4,000 career yards on the ground.
Yeah, he had 170 yards just last week, two touchdowns. It wasn't a big challenge, right, in the game, but 1,900 yards. Just expect to watch Brandon Marshall. He's low to the ground. He's a strong runner. Expect to watch him carry the ball 15 to 20 times today and carry the load for the Vikings.
A three-star recruit. His biggest offer right now from North Dakota State, one of the top FCS programs in the nation. Big change for Cocoa in the offseason came at the head coaching position. John Wilkinson, who built this program into a perennial power, left to go to New Smyrna Beach, an opportunity to coach his son. So in comes former UCF quarterback Ryan Schneider. His first head coaching opportunity comes with his Cocoa powerhouse.
And what a first season. I mean, how do you ever build on that, right? But this guy knows what he's doing. He's been around for a long time and had great success. So here he is in his first year and just following in the footsteps and got his team poised to potentially take home a state title.
Schneider actually played collegiately in this stadium when it was known as the Citrus Bowl as UCF's quarterback, and now he returns with an opportunity to win a championship as a coach. Alex Petrozello with the kickoff for Cocoa. Reigns will touch it first. This is Daveris Thomas out beyond the 30, spinning his way out of a tackle and absorbs a huge shot as he gets to the 41-yard line. That was Tyreek Sears that planted Thomas.
But a great start for the Vikings. Good return. Almost a block in the back. Held off of it very well. Get out here at past the 40-yard line. Big hit, but the 40-yard line is just where you want to start.
This Reigns offense has scored more than 42 points in all of their postseason games, but this is just the second start of the season for Ja'Cory Rivers. The 5'9 senior left-hander started last week's state semifinal against Dunellen. Coach Duran Wiley told us it's been competitive between Rivers and Baron Coates throughout the season. Rivers has just been more impressive in practice the last couple of weeks. So he gets the start here on the state's biggest stage, and the Vikings can't get the playoff in time.
Repeat 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Austin, I've seen that happen in so many games, even the NFL, but I never understand how you don't go out and know, you know, the personnel, the formation, and the play, first play of the game.
So they'll start from the 36. Rivers wants to cut it loose, has pressure, and DeJavon White spins him down at the 26.
Well, I wonder, Austin, if going first and 15 changed the play caller, if they expected to try to go deep on the first play of the game no matter what. But what a start for Coco.
De'Javon White, an outstanding talent. He started in this championship game as an eighth grader. Now as a sophomore, that was his 15th and a half sack. First touch for Brandon Marshall, and he finds no room. Alan Pierce, the linebacker, got a hold of the jersey, and the Tigers rallied to the football.
What I'm interested to see on both of these defenses, one runs a 3-3-5, and the other runs a 4-2-5. They implement more defensive backs than usual. We'll take a look at that. We're looking at a 3-3-5 here for Coco to start the game. Looked good on the first two plays.
Third down and 23. Rivers, well protected by that big offensive line. Now he's going to tuck it down and run. Gets to the 45, and he's banged down near midfield. That'll be about 3 yards shy of a first down and a decision for Duran Wiley.
You're right. I mean, this is a decision. You're at the 48-yard line, 3 yards to go, and you just had a big-time run by your quarterback. Rivers really makes, I think, a lot of fans on the Coco side hold their breath there for a moment, and here they are lining up in a regular formation.
Well, fourth down and 3 on the opening possession of the game. The Vikings are going to go for it. Marshall next to Rivers. Play clock down to 5.
When you haven't been scored on in the last two games, you kind of think our defense may be able to hold them.
Delay on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat fourth down.
Well, looking down at the sideline, Duran Wiley tried to get a timeout. He wanted his offense to stay out there, but the official said he didn't get the signal in time.
Now, that's surprising, and I'm glad that he wanted to take the timeout because, your punt game is not always dependable. So don't take a 5-yard penalty at this. Take that timeout, and I'm glad that that's what he was trying to do, but unfortunately, they weren't able to get that call before the penalty.
Wiley, a 1993 Reigns grad. His high school teammate was former NFL standout Brian Dawkins, who is in the house tonight cheering on his great friend. There's the punt from Deveris Thomas. It hits Willie Gaines, and Reigns recovers near the 10. A huge mistake on special teams from Coco's best player sets up the Vikings in scoring position.
Oh, devastating, devastating for Coco. And Austin, of all the high school football that I watch, punt returns are the least properly executed across the board. I don't care what division you're watching or what level. Not enough high school players know how to properly return punts. Either get away from it or fair catch it, but that was the last thing you wanted to do. Now the ball's right at the 11, and the defense is right back out on the field.
Marshall's second carry, tracked down from behind. It's Tyreek Sears, the defensive end. Show you the Reigns offense, backs and receivers. Deveris Thomas, 518 yards receiving, 9 touchdowns, part of an athletic receiving core. Drayton has offers from some FBS level schools, and they are big up front, the right side. Ford and Holbert both check in at 330 pounds. Rivers trying to run wide. Flag comes in as Rivers scores a touchdown, but let's check the penalty.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty. Repeat. Second down.
Unfortunate for the Vikings here because Rivers was way out in front. This hold, the ref either took a long time to throw the flag, but the way he was looking, it was way behind the play. He would have scored the touchdown easily, but now they're going to back it up. Most likely 10 or more yards. It's a spot of the foul. 10 yards from the spot of the foul.
Actually, they'll put the ball at the 15. It'll be second down and 10. Vikings can get a first down close to the 1, so it's essentially second down and goal.
Well, you saw the speed that Rivers has, both on the long run that set up the fourth down and that almost touchdown run.
And movement on the left side of that offensive line. I think it was Bryant Maddox.
prior to the snap. False start on the offense. Repeat, second down.
Already the third penalty against Reigns. Seen a holding call wipe out a touchdown, but the Vikings in scoring position after a muffed punt by Coco's Willie Gaines. Rivers throws complete, and they'll rule it now incomplete. That was Daveris Thomas. Looked like he might have caught it and then put it on the ground, but the referees immediately rule it incomplete.
It's a game of inches, Austin, and this was, watch how close this is. Definitely on the ground.
So now third down and 19. Good hit delivered by freshman O.J. Ross.
How big will it be for Coco's defense if they're able to withstand this for either a field goal or maybe no points at all?
Well, this is at the edge of Nigel Smith's range, and another false start against Reigns.
Prior to the snap, false start, 5-yard penalty, repeat, third down.
Coach Duran Wiley told us he would be willing to try a field goal from Smith between 30 and 35 yards. From here, it would be a 42-yarder. So Reigns has got to pick up some yardage here to even consider a field goal attempt. Recovered the fumbled punt at the 11. They're all the way back at the 25. Rivers gets away from pressure, again trying to scramble. He goes down for a 1-yard gain right in front of Jaquez Hicks.
Offense is staying on the field.
Vikings have to get it to the 1-yard line to get a first down. So again, it's essentially fourth down and goal here with the ball at the 24.
And if you tried a field goal, you would only move it up to the 20. If you tried and missed, but you got it into the end zone, the ball would come back out to the 20. So no real point in even trying that.
Rivers throwing it up toward the end zone, and it out of bounds, incomplete. Thomas looking for a flag with Cedric Hawkins, the eighth grader, in coverage.
Wow, they ran a similar wheel route up the sideline for the last two plays. That one almost came down, and the receiver got touched there right before the ball came in. Receiver looking for a penalty, but not going to get it.
So now Ryan Schneider gets to send his offense out there. What a huge stand by that Coco defense. Sophomore Diego Arroyo leads the Tigers out onto the field. Set the single-season passing yardage record over 3,000 with 28 touchdowns for the sophomore. First read wasn't there, nearly intercepted as he was trying to go to Willie Gaines.
Can you imagine if it was intercepted and Reigns gets the ball back again? But the numbers we just saw for Arroyo, amazing. Over 3,000 yards in high school is almost unheard of. I mean, there's a few of these Elite 11 type guys that get some big numbers like that, but those are fantastic numbers. Coach Schneider, obviously, the quarterback, and coaching him.
The fake to Keziah Holmes. Pass is caught. This is going to go for negative yardage. DeMarquez Henley got belted by Jaron Wilson. Here are the Coco offense. Backs and receivers. Holmes is a four-star recruit, has offers from Miami, Florida, and Kentucky. Rushed for more than 1,100 yards this year. Isaiah Jones has had a really productive season. And up front, a lot of new faces on the offensive line. Hunter Gaffel started at left guard last year. He's now at center. Richie Leonard, 6'4", 285-pound junior, is Kentucky commit. Here's a screen to Holmes with lots of room. Out beyond the 30, he's going to be very close to a first down at the 34-yard line.
This has to be measured, or they're just going to give it to him because it is right on the line. They gave it to him. Nice play call. I like this. Good setup on the screen.
Couldn't get any of his offensive linemen out in front, but there was plenty of room for Holmes. had a career high in carries last week, toted it 24 times for 130 yards. Arroyo pumps and throws it for gains. Incomplete and no flag. Some contact with Trayvon Hobbs in coverage. Here is the Reigns defense. Tough group up front with Jamon Goodwine, a third-year starter, and Janoris Robertson, who has 10 sacks. The linebackers are outstanding. Bonsall, Horn, and Nigel Allen. Horn is an Iowa State commit. And in the secondary, Trayvon Hobbs, 4 interceptions this year. James Tarver Jr. has 5 picks. On second down and 10, Arroyo off target looking for Isaiah Jones.
Austin, on the previous play that went to Gaines, he was wide open actually for the entire play to the very last second when the safety came in and knocked the ball away. I don't know how he got that wide open. I didn't see the exact setup as the receivers went down the field, but we'll see if they come back to that or if it was just a broken play, a broken coverage where they're not going to get that open again. But Gaines was wide open on the previous play.
Play clock down under 5. Arroyo does not get it off. I thought he beat the play clock, but the flag comes in from the back judge.
Delay on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat. Third down.
So instead of 3rd and 10, it's 3rd and 15.
One thing about this championship, so when you do have the 25-second clocks in the corners of the end zone, in regular season games, you usually don't have that. I think refs are sometimes a little bit lenient. If they think they're going to snap the ball, they let the play go. But when you can see the play clock, you're not going to get away with it as much.
Arroyo has pressure, and down he goes. This athletic and physical defensive front collapsed the pocket around Diego Arroyo and give Janoris Robertson his 11th sack of the year.
He felt it, came around good. Stepped up in the pocket, but there just wasn't that much space inside to get rid of it. Right now we're seeing a defensive battle.
Alex Petrozello is the punter for Coco. Averages around 40 yards per punt. Deveris Thomas back to receive for the Vikings. Makes the fair catch at the 42. Near the midway point of this first quarter, scoreless in the 4A title game between Coco and Reigns. Vikings in back-to-back championship games. First time that's happened for a Duval County public school in 50 years. It's been very little success for public schools from Duval County. Reigns' title a year ago was the first for a Duval County public school. They're the only school that's ever won it. 2 state championships for the Vikings. And Coco, this is the 12th year in a row they've advanced to at least the state semifinals. First down completion, Thomas with a catch and run into Coco territory. These two teams, perennial contenders in 4A the last several years, and they've really been on the rise as of late.
Water break.
Quickness from Thomas. You saw just get the ball outside and let the quickness happen. We saw Rivers, how fast he is. Thomas, quick and fast. That's the thing that's going to be tough for Coco to keep together for 4 quarters.
Coco's success, starting with Wilkinson and now continuing with Ryan Schneider, just incredible. They went almost 9 years without losing a game to a Brevard County opponent. And worth mentioning again, 12 consecutive seasons they have been to at least the state semifinals.
When you come here and you start August 1st, you just plan to play the first week of December.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a different mindset. Not a lot of high schools do that. You know, I mean, you got Lakeland, you got Plant from the Tampa area. You've got a number of schools that just plan to be here in December. This is one of the best.
Coco 4-1 in championship games. Won 3 consecutative state titles from 2008 to 2010. And then won it again 2 years ago. So after the catch and run by Thomas, here's Brandon Marshall probing for space and finding none. De'Javon White helping to collapse the Reigns offensive line. Here are the Tigers defensively. Talked a little bit about White already. Athletic defensive ends in Sears and Freeman. In the linebacking corps, Brock Holland is the team's leading tackler. He's a transfer from Vieira, second consecutive year with 100 or more tackles. And a lot of youth in the secondary. Hicks, a sophomore. O.J. Ross is a freshman. We'll see a lot of Willie Gaines and Keziah Holmes in the secondary tonight. Marshall gets some space, and you see his athleticism. With a flag down, he is at the 25.
See, Brandon Marshall gets a good runoff, and pretty sure it's going to go backwards. Reigns right now is bringing an extra lineman in.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty. Repeat. Second down.
And run to the strong side. Both times to the right side. They've run to that side with that extra lineman. That one looked good. The one before that, Coco was ready for it. But they're making it, basically, they're having one less eligible receiver on the field than they need to, because they're adding an extra guy on the line of scrimmage without, you know, you don't have to do that. They've chosen to.
Already six penalties against Reigns, including one that wiped away a touchdown. Ball marked at the 37 for second down and five. Deep drop by Rivers, holding it for a long time, eludes a tackle, stays on his feet at the 30, and goes out of bounds near the 15-yard line. What a tremendous individual effort by Ja'Cory Rivers.
And I thought his clock, his internal clock, was going to deceive him, because I thought he was going to get hit in the back right here. And he pops out of there, and I mean, Michael Vick-ish, right? The
yeah.
Lefty, and pretty darn elusive.
And wearing
speed.
Number seven.
Yeah.
Rivers has primarily been a wide receiver for this season. Dual threat quarterback, but played well last week, accounted for four total touchdowns, two passing, two rushing, had more than 100 yards on the ground. Design run all the way. That size of Reigns just leaning on the Coco defensive line as another flag comes in behind the play.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty. Repeat. First down.
It's almost time for coach to call a timeout and say, our athletes are so good, we don't need you to hold. Do not hold. We will take care of it. Look, right there, they shifted to the left side with that extra offensive lineman. They also put Marshall in front of Rivers, the quarterback, and let him be the running back. So they got two extra blockers on the strong side, and it looked pretty darn good, except for the hold, which I think was behind the play.
You got Matt Drayton lined up close to the end of the line of scrimmage. Immediate pressure on Rivers, and he's running again. Able to stay in bounds down inside the 10. Brock Holland pushed him out.
He's not going down with only one player getting him, is he? He's stepping out of that first tackle every time. He's going to be a tough guy to pull down in the second half as people start to wear down. Get a little bit more tired, a few more arm tackles, and you've already seen him. He's already getting out of the arm tackles when guys are fresh. Defense has been on the field almost the entire first quarter.
Second down and two. Rivers going to throw it outside to Thomas. Keziah Holmes does a good job playing that. A gain of about three, but it'll be enough to set up the Vikings with first and goal.
He did a nice job tracking him to the sideline, but they pick up that first down. But I think some of the way they've set up that Vikings can do these type of quick throws to the outside and probably be successful, move the ball downfield, very low risk, but I think they have some pretty high reward with their quickness.
Marshall threw a hole and into the end zone for a Reigns touchdown.
Right, spread out both sides. They put two receivers out wide on each side. Got everybody spread out and then found a nice open spot right inside the tackle. Nice kick out block. Gonna be hard to stop Marshall. We saw those numbers. 1,900 yards on the season, 24 touchdowns, and almost 8 yards a carry.
Nigel Smith is the Vikings kicker. Straight on approach. And he knocks it through to make it 7-0.
See the inside work of the offensive lineman. Everybody's stretching and reaching. Great job by the right guard, Howard Ford. We're used to scoring points. They have not been challenged in the last two games, not giving up a point. Put over 40 in both games.
Marshall rushed for more than 1,700 yards last year, and Duran Wiley told us getting ready for the 4A title game that it was the best single season any running back has had since he became the head coach. So naturally, I asked him this week, what has this year been like for Marshall? And he said he's exceeded even what he did last year. A phenomenal career for him, now over 4,000 yards, and he is the school's all-time leading rusher.
Hard not to be when you got 2 years, almost 2,000 yards. And when you get to play to the state title game each year, that helps add to your stats as well.
Rains had a touchdown wiped away because of a holding penalty, but they're able to punch it in on Brandon Marshall's 25th touchdown run of the year. They jump in front. This is a very short kick fielded at the 34-yard line. Coco going to end up with great field position, dragging defenders near midfield is DeMarquez Henley. Coco located in Brevard County, right in the center of Brevard County, enrollment of just over 1,000. Bob Anderson is in the College Football Hall of Fame. James Folston played linebacker in the NFL. Several of his relatives have been part of this Coco program. And Carrot Top, among the notable alumni.
Played linebacker in the NFL? No?
I don't think he quite got to that level. Tight formation for the Tigers on first down from midfield. Here's Keziah Holmes, able to get to the edge. Holmes has a first down, driven out of bounds at the 35.
Coming back there, Austin. Not very many teams, I'm guessing, can get the corner on that kind of a play against a Reigns defense.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty. Repeat. First down.
Not sure if the hold allowed Holmes to get around the corner or not, but I said, you know, that long of a play, they have too much speed on defense to have that happen with very much success.
It moves the ball back to the 39. Ends up being an 11-yard loss for Coco. First and 21.
Penalties playing a big part of this first quarter on both teams.
Arroyo on target to Jamari Williams, who's spun down at the 46. Williams had the game-winning touchdown catch last week as Coco had that thrilling rally against University School to win 32-31. Offense built on rhythm and timing, and so far the Tigers haven't had much of it against the speed and athleticism of the Vikings. There's a touch for O.J. Ross, and he is swallowed by that Reigns defensive front.
Well, the tough thing, Austin, is conventional thinking. That was a run box where you take a look and see how many people. There was only five guys, a four-down lineman and a linebacker, and you have got to run into that because they've got six guys covering your four wide receivers on the outside, and they got nothing. They got stymied. So then you start throwing into their strength where they got the six on four, and that makes it tough on the quarterback and everybody else.
Arroyo well protected as he throws. Nice catch made about 3 yards shy of the first down. Second catch on that series for Jamari Williams. It's going to be fourth down and 3 or 4.
They're going to stay on the field as well.
Coco going for it here on fourth down. Or at least trying to draw Reigns offside. Holmes back out there. Vikings bring pressure as Arroyo throws. Caught by Gaines, and he nearly broke it for a touchdown. Just couldn't keep his feet, but a conversion on fourth down for the Tigers.
Well, a minute ago we said inches away on that interception potential. He was inches on the shoestring tackle. Gaines almost was in the back of the end zone. Right now, slants are the name of the game for Coco's offense. They've hit him on both sides of the field.
Good drive put together by Coco, and they'll get a free 5 yards, courtesy of Jaron Wilson.
Prior to the snap, encroachment on the defense. 5 yard penalty. Repeat, first down.
Wilson with push-ups because of the mistake. Junior has been incredibly productive as part of a rotation on that defensive front. Keziah Holmes, tough run between the tackles, turns his back to that first down marker, and they will give him a favorable spot. First down run for Holmes at the 20.
You're right about a favorable spot as he backed his way. Not very close to that line, it didn't look like, and they put it right on the line and gave him the first down.
Coco drive started with an 11-yard holding penalty after a short kickoff, but they've worked it down deep in Reigns territory. Here's Gaines on a speed sweep. Good blocking downfield. Gaines can't quite stay in bounds, and a flag is dropped. They're going to get Isaiah Jones for a hold downfield.
Way downfield, right before Gaines got to him. It'll only take the ball back to the 15-yard line, so it's going to be first and 5, I guess. It's 10 yards from the spot of the foul, and it was 5 yards past the first down marker.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty. Repeat. First down.
Well, you get a glimpse of what Gaines can do in the open field. Jeff mentioned it in the open, but Ryan Schneider said Willie Gaines is the best high school player he's ever been around with a combination of speed and athleticism. It says a lot when you consider that Schneider was the offensive coordinator for two state championship teams at St. Thomas Aquinas and another state championship at University School. He has seen a lot of talent. First down and 5. Here's Holmes trying to get to the edge. Ball is free. Still loose. Finally picked up by Reigns and returned to the 34. They lost it again. The officials will say that he was down. James Hall had the fumble recovery, and the ball's going to stay with Reigns.
Two big mistakes for Coco's offense on a special teams punt return. Here, that's just an easy punch out. Holmes was not protecting that ball very well. And I think that was the right call. He slammed down on the ground before he gave it up. But what an opportunity. Their offense was doing so well, moving the ball down the field to give it up. Right back to Reigns' offense.
Javon Bonsall was the player who forced the fumble. James Hall, the defensive lineman, recovered it. And here comes Brandon Marshall in the Reigns' offense.
Flags are just raining down every single play, Austin.
Already 11 accepted penalties in this first quarter.
There were fouls on both teams. We had holding on the offense, illegal substitution on the defense. Those penalties offset. We repeat, first down.
Well, mistakes by both teams in this opening quarter, but Coco has made the bigger errors. Mishandled punt inside their own 15-yard line, and then a fumble when they had a chance to score. more elusiveness from Ja'Cory Rivers. That, for me, is the story of this fourth quarter, how productive he has been running the football for Reigns.
Yeah, he's looked very, very good. And to imagine not playing that much, really just coming in last week as the main guy. But obviously, like Coach said, they've been competing. He's ready to go, and he looks great.
Near 60 yards rushing in this opening quarter, and now here's Marshall. De'Javon White and Allen Pierce combine on the stop. Should be just shy of the first down as we hit the end of this first quarter.
That's the end of the first quarter.
Lone touchdown in the opening quarter was scored by Brandon Marshall, the Reigns senior running back. And after one here at Camping World Stadium, it is 7-0 in favor of the Vikings. We're back for the second quarter of this 4A championship game. You're streaming on Spectrum Sports. 7-0 Reigns as we start the second quarter here at Camping World Stadium. Reigns located in Duval County. And how about the notable alumni? Three guys who played in the NFL, Harold Carmichael, Brian Dawkins, and Jabbar Gaffney. There is a long list of alums for Reigns that have played in Super Bowls, including those guys you saw. Add to that list, Lito Shepard, Sean Jefferson, Calvin Muhammad. This is a proud program with a lot of alums that care greatly about its success. Duran Wiley, the last several years, telling us about how engaged the past standouts are in the success of the current players.
Harold Carmichael goes back before my time, but he was a 6'8" wide receiver for the Philadelphia Eagles.
Rivers once again escaping pressure, giving chase is Tyreek Sears, and he'll turn it into a gain of about 3. I didn't know there were football players before your time.
Ouch. That's all I can say. Ouch. No, but to see a 6'8" guy, you know, quarterback's like, man, if I could only throw to a guy that size.
That's right.
Think about that wingspan and just the old space you could throw to him. We had face masks when I played.
Thought the leather helmets had face masks? I didn't know that.
We had to tape them on, though.
Ball right on the midfield stripe. Rivers not getting away this time. De'Javon White with his second sack. Richie Leonard was also in there on the pressure.
You're right, just a sophomore, 255, but he's already made a big, big dent on this defense. Two sacks to start the game.
Both of these coaches heaping a lot of praise on De'Javon White. Just a sophomore, Ryan Schneider said he's among the best in the state at his position, but he's not going to get recruited because of his size, just 5'10". And Duran Wiley as well just couldn't say enough positive things about how productive White is at his defensive tackle position.
Well, you know what? He's going to get recruited because they're going to move him inside and make him a nose tackle, and he's going to be devastating.
Rivers on a design run has a first down inside the Coco 40 in the offensive line, helping to push the pile a few more yards downfield.
Coco's offense, while they had success, they're going to have to control the ball a little bit here in the second quarter as they get the ball back, whenever that is, because the defense will wear down in the second half with Reigns. They're big and they're strong and they come hard, and it's going to wear out in a little bit.
Marshall trying to get to the perimeter. Well, you can see his burst. Cedric Hawkins, the eighth grade corner, looked like he had the angle and line him up, and Marshall just has another gear.
Yeah, you know, he's not that big, 5'9", 184, but he's just, look at his calves, he's a stud. And he's just a tough guy to bring down.
Marshall already over 100, Reigns as a team over 100 yards. There is Brian Dawkins, former standout cornerback in the NFL, liking what he's seeing so far. Again, Dawkins was the high school teammate of Reigns coach Duran Wiley. those two good friends, and another example of just how the players that have come through this program are always there to support the current crop of Vikings.
Well, if the Vikings can keep their hands to themselves and not hold anymore, you're starting to see spaces coming up already here in the second quarter, a little bit more running space.
Marshall dragged down by Pierce near another first down. They're moving the chains on the ground with the combination of Marshall and Rivers.
Yeah, I can see this becoming a power run game and using their quarterback in the power run game as well, bringing an extra big offensive lineman in and running into it with Marshall blocking. We saw that earlier in the first quarter.
Got the tight end Keto Burke lined up on the end of the line of scrimmage. Incomplete, and multiple flags are thrown. Jordan Blackman in coverage.
I disagree on first glance. I disagree. Thought this ball was behind him before the drag down from behind. That is not pass interference. That's a bad call.
Defensive pass interference. Half the distance to the goal. Repeat, first down.
Let's take another look at it from ground level, but see if we can get it. That's not pass interference in my book.
Yeah, I agree with you. Blackman makes contact as the ball arrives. It's a rough call for Coco. Here's Jamon Handy with his first carry, and he powers his way into the end zone.
Interesting play design as the offensive line pulled and went away from the play call. So it gave the linebackers a mixed look for the read. And he finds his way into the end zone on the sweep.
Handy is the change of pace back in this Reigns offense. Nigel Smith 2 for 2 on PATs. Under 8 minutes to go here in the first half. It is 14-0 Reigns.
Good power for the smaller guy.
And Handy listed at just 158 yeah. pounds.
Coco's got to be settled now and be very methodical about a scoring drive. Obviously, clock's not a factor, but it is in that you don't want Reigns to get the ball back and be able to, you know, keep Coco's defense on the field again. So they want to really control this last 7:51 and put a score on the board before halftime, not trying to score quick and then try to get the ball back a second time and tie it up before halftime. In my opinion, you're just trying to get 14-7, but keep your defense off the field, because right now they've been on the field way too much in the first half, and you're going to see that power run game come early in that third quarter, and it could get ugly.
You got a sense as that drive continued that the Coco defense was wearing down a little bit. First Reigns kickoff was very short, and this one is all out of whack. Vikings players ahead of the kicker. So they will back up to the 35 and try it again. It's Matt Drayton, the starting wide receiver, that handles the kickoffs.
I think those squibs are commonplace here for the Vikings.
Gaines and Keziah Holmes back deep, the two most dynamic athletes on this Coco roster, but each has made a big mistake so far. Gaines mishandling a punt, Holmes fumbling with his team in position to score. This is one of the up men from the 35, and good coverage by Reigns. DeMarquez Henley returns it close to the 40. Well, Coco has set the standard for success among Central Florida programs. No school has more state football championships, four for Coco, and all of them have come in the last 10 years, starting with that run of three in a row in 2008. Popka and Merritt Island each with three, handful of teams with two. Ryan Schneider said it was a no-brainer to apply for this job when it came open, referred to this program as an empire, and their success matches that.
He's right, and he's stepped right in. He's taken this young quarterback who's thrown for over 3,000 yards and got him right back here into this championship. They've got to get it going and be consistent, no holding penalties.
Gaines bumped out of bounds by Uriah Ratliff. Now, Gaines was primarily a running back last year. They have moved him to wide receiver, and he's thrived. Last year had almost 1,400 yards rushing, and this year over 1,000 yards receiving.
He's dynamic. They just haven't had the ball very much to even get a look at it. Up in his face at the top of the screen.
Down the middle, there's Isaiah Jones. He's been a big addition to this team. Moved from Pennsylvania in the middle of the summer. This is his first year playing football, primarily a basketball player. Ryan Schneider talked him into coming out for football, and he's near 1,000 yards receiving on the season.
Look at those numbers.
Coco in Reigns territory again as Arroyo takes a deep shot well over the head of Gaines.
That was a miscommunication for sure. Post route by Gaines, and Arroyo threw it up the sideline. It was a one-on-one. I like the idea. You got your most dynamic player, and he's one-on-one situation. You got to throw it all the time. If there's no underneath defender and no safety moved over, you got to throw it to him a lot. But that was a mix-up.
That was Trayvon Hobbs heading to the sideline for Reigns, a starting free safety. It's been a pleasant surprise this year in the secondary for the Vikings. So second down and 10. Arroyo hit as he let it go. And once again, throwing with Tarver in coverage, trying to find Jones.
Isaiah Jones fell down. He actually was on the ground when the ball came out.
Important third down for Coco. Want to move closer to the end zone, want to give your defense a little bit more time to rest. And before the play, Reigns burns the timeout.
Timeout. Defense.
Reigns, a program that is starting to become a frequent stop of college coaches when they get into the Jacksonville area. No shortage of talent on this roster the last 3 years. Here are the most notable recruits this year. Drayton, the wide receiver, has some FBS offers. Miami, UConn, South Alabama among them. Eric Horn committed to Iowa State. And then Brandon Marshall with FCS interest. North Dakota State is his biggest offer. Duran Wiley did tell us that UCF and USF have shown a lot of interest recently in Marshall. Based on what you've seen, how do you think he would fit in with those level of programs?
Well, the offense is perfect for him. He'd be great at it because this is exactly what they already do. This is what they want to do. Spread it out and let that guy find space.
On third and 10, Arroyo finds Gaines, who wins one-on-one. It'll be first and goal for Coco. They pick on Donald Ross, who just came into the game to replace the injured Trayvon Hobbs.
Austin, when teams blitz, you say, you know, you're going to blitz until you can beat the blitz and until you prove that you can beat the blitz. Well, they're going one-on-one with their best receiver, and until you can beat him like he just did, they don't need to play a safety over the top or do anything other. I said that they're going to have to throw it to him a lot in one-on-one, and he made it happen here down to the five.
De'Javon White comes in as a blocker. Holmes not much. He does get it inside the five.
Yeah, I'd be afraid to change my offense down here at the five from something we haven't seen from Coco yet. And I don't know if a power game inside and tighten it up from the five is going to get yourself into the end zone against Rain's defense. They're going to think about it.
Timeout on the offense. Their first timeout.
So a huge moment in this game as Ryan Schneider wants to make sure his offense is on the same page.
Yeah, I agree. I think they needed to think about it because I think they went into the tight offense at the five is too far away for them against Reigns.
Coco trying to win its fifth state championship. Won it back in 2016. And Reigns, as we mentioned, looking for back-to-back titles. Their other championship came in 1997. They are the only public school in Duval County to ever win a state title. That could change this weekend. The Mandarin Mustangs are in their first ever state championship game with Alabama commit Carson Beck at quarterback. Mandarin will play in the large class final, the 8A championship game here Saturday night. Out of the timeout, it's an empty backfield. Here comes Gaines in motion. They'll flip it to Holmes. That's a pass, and he gets in for the touchdown. Creative play call from Ryan Schneider, and the Tigers are on the board.
And it was the right type of play to change it up. They brought the four wide receivers. They were still tight, but it was four wide receivers in their back, and then they went misdirection. And that's what you got to do to beat a Reigns defense like that. Just going straight at them wasn't going to get them there, and they thought about it, took the timeout, and make the great call and get Holmes into the end zone for the first score of the night.
A good patience by Arroyo, too. Waited until a defender came up the field to flip it to Holmes. Petrozello adds the PAT. Coco cuts the deficit in half. Arroyo gets credit for the touchdown pass. Holmes did most of the work.
Take a look. You get the speed sweep look. You got the linebackers got to respect it. And then they come back inside with a big back. Holmes knows what to do to get it into the end zone.
Holmes has been a beast. That's his third receiving touchdown. Gives him 18 total scores on the year. He started on defense last year. Always a quarterback or a running back growing up in youth football, but John Wilkinson persuaded him to play defense. Said he could be like Chauncey Gardner-Johnson, who right now is at Florida and headed for the NFL. Jamel Dean is an outstanding corner in college as well. And with Ryan Schneider coming in, Keziah back on offense and contributing in a big way to Coco's success. Petrozello can't get it quite to the end zone. This is Jamon Handy, who scored the last touchdown for Reigns. Coco defenders had an angle, but a late hit after Handy was out of bounds.
Yeah, you said it well after. He was out past the full three, four yard. Look at this, way outside, 6 feet.
After the play was over, personal foul on the kicking team. 15-yard penalty would be added to the end of the run.
Put it out nearly the 45-yard line. Great. I was talking about just holding on that ball a little bit and, you know, you taking some time to get down the field and make it 14-7. Well, now there's 6 minutes left on the clock, and you put the ball at the 44-yard line. You set yourself up to be down 21-7 instead of 14-7.
Coco did get the score. First points allowed by Reigns in their last three games.
They don't have enough guys on the line of scrimmage. This should be an illegal formation.
It's Marshall. Couldn't get anywhere. Zachary Gay was the first defender to make contact with him, the 290-pound sophomore defensive tackle.
See if they do that formation again, Austin. I believe that was an illegal formation. Not enough guys on the line of scrimmage. Should have cost them five. No game. To call that the cross buck. Now they do it with the jet sweep look.
Well, given how productive the offense has been, I think the down is probably more important than the 5 yards. Rain's going to be in third and long. Marquise Freeman able to spin Rivers down, and that's one of their scenarios where so far in the game Rivers has been able to get away. Not that time.
And you know what, when your offense comes through and scores points, it makes your defense get that second wind, get excited. That adrenaline pumps back up.
Third down and 9 for Reigns. Rivers again under pressure, and he's going down for a sack. Freeman on back-to-back plays gets to Ja'Cory Rivers, and the Cocoa defense comes up with a 3-and-out.
Been talking about Cocoa's defense getting tired, and they said, "Who's that? What's that guy talking about? We're ready to go." And they look great after the touchdown on the offense, giving themselves another chance to get here and maybe tie it up and still have plenty of time left, 4.5 minutes.
Freeman and Sears, good athletes. They're not big, both less than 200 pounds, but they come flying off the edge.
Offense, right side of the offensive line's offsides. They lined up in the neutral zone. Doesn't happen that often, but the offense is going to be offsides.
Prior to the play, encroachment on the offense. Repeat, fourth down.
A chance at redemption here for Willie Gaines. Muffed a punt the last time he was back to return.
And if he gets any chance at a return, it'll be a good one.
Thomas with a high kick. Gaines going to stay away. And it's downed at the 39. Now, we got used to seeing Coco as a physical run-based offense with John Wilkinson as their head coach. In comes Ryan Schneider, a college quarterback, and they are spread, slinging it all over the yard, throwing for almost 270 yards per game. Schneider acknowledged, look, we're much different philosophically, but we want to maintain the toughness and physical nature. That's always going to be a hallmark of Cocoa football.
Well, those numbers, that change is amazing, and they're more entertaining to watch now, I can tell you that. I haven't called a 4A game, but I remember watching it from the sideline and, having a running back run from the quarterback position just about every play. Now it's a lot more fun to watch.
Bruce Judson was a 4-year starter for Coco. He got to the state championship game last year in the first season without Judson. And now Diego Arroyo, just a sophomore, moved into the area before the start of spring football and won the starting job. It's been a record-setting year. Holmes that time stood up and driven down at the line of scrimmage. It'll bring up 3rd and 4 as we tick down near 3 minutes to go here in the first half.
Plenty of time with 2 timeouts left, but they did get up on the ball quickly and are moving fast.
Schneider, the head coach, and also the play caller.
Throw the ball down to the bottom of the screen. I'll give you a dollar if they don't.
Arroyo on the slant, nearly intercepted. Great break by Jarius Stewart.
Stewart was thinking the same thing I was, and he knew that that's what they've been good at so far, that the slants have been good to Coco so far, and he makes a great break on the ball. Big time play gives his team another chance with just under 3 minutes left.
Stewart, a lockdown corner on this defense, routinely goes up and makes plays against taller wide receivers. He's 5'9", Williams was 6'3", found himself in that situation again. It's a high kick by Petrozello, but not far at all. And it gets a break with a little bit of a hop. But Coco not able to pin Reigns deep. And with 2.5 minutes to go, the Vikings will take over at their own 31.
Actually got, from what it originally looked like when that ball went straight up in the air, they got about a 24-yard punt off. It looked like it wasn't going to go anywhere. So not a disaster, but still you did not want to give the ball up one more time to the fast-breaking Reigns offense with 2:34 left.
Three and out for the Vikings on their last possession. But they have pounded this Coco defense so far. Here's a quick throw out to Thomas. Speedster gets upfield and will have a first down out beyond the 40.
I think another great mark, a great spot. Maybe he got the first down, but they gave him the first down and then some.
Reigns with two timeouts and 2 minutes and 20 seconds to try and add to a 14-7 lead. Marshall played well by the two defensive ends. Sears and Freeman combine on the stop.
Reigns also has two timeouts. Still with 2 minutes. That's a lot of time in high school football.
Marshall so far 55 yards on 12 carries. There's a completion and a missed tackle. Into Coco territory goes Davian Holloman with his first catch of the night. Richie Leonard, starting offensive lineman who's seen a lot of time at defensive tackle tonight, was the one who made the tackle downfield.
A lot of times, Austin, I think about teams throughout the regular season when you see that broken tackle and you know how good the players are on Coco, of just how easy that turns into a 60-yard touchdown pass in the regular season.
Rivers still scanning. White pressuring as Rivers throws it over the Coco sideline. Dejavon White is gassed as he heads back to the defensive line.
If anything you did, you tired out that defensive line a little bit more for the second half.
Started in this game as a 13-year-old, had 7 sacks as an 8th grader playing defensive line. Rivers with Marshall as the lead blocker. Clock ticking now, under 1:15 to go. And the Vikings at the Coco 32, ready for 3rd down and 6.
Rivers not too concerned with the clock.
And because of the kicking situation, this is certainly 2-down territory. Reigns with 2 timeouts, but doesn't mean you can take your time here in the last minute. Rivers all day to scan, and now he takes off. Leonard couldn't get him as Rivers breaks it to the outside. He'll be stood up and driven down at the 20.
They are going to take their timeout. Clock was stopped momentarily for the first down, but they are going to take their timeout.
So 31 seconds to go, and Reigns uses the second of their 3 timeouts.
Timeout. Reigns, their second charge timeout.
You see, Rivers is really like the MVP of this first half. He's just been elusive, tough to bring down. We heard that maybe Coach would get some time, but I would be hard-pressed to take Rivers out of this game. He's just played very, very well.
Amazing that this is just the second start of the season for Ja'Cory Rivers. Baron Coates started 90% of the games this year, took a large majority of the snaps. But Duran Wiley told us they want their kids to compete for starting positions every single week. And in the last couple of weeks, Rivers had just been a little bit better. And it was nothing that Baron Coates hadn't done. He's continued to exhibit great leadership, and Duran Wiley says he brings a calm to the position. You see the numbers, not bad
it's
at
hard
all.
To beat those numbers. Fantastic. 77% completion percentage.
And Coach certainly ready if his number is called, but right now it's Ja'Cory Rivers who's got 88 yards on the ground, 48 yards passing, and his team in position to extend a 14-7 lead.
Awesome. We saw what happened with Alabama just this past week with needing 2 quarterbacks, 2 quality quarterbacks.
Rivers puts the ball on the ground, covers it back at the 28, and now Reigns has got to burn their last timeout.
3rd and final timeout, Reigns.
And that's where just a little bit of the confusion came with getting set up with your formation and your play. They were just kind of sauntering to the line of scrimmage. Now they're down 24 seconds, and still can get a first down easily enough, but they are going to have only a couple plays left.
And we're going to see a change at quarterback. You see Miss Raines, 2018 and 2019 there, enjoying the game.
Well, just as we were talking about it, here comes Baron Coates. 1,800 yards on the season, 21 touchdowns.
Rivers more of a dual threat. Coates is a guy who is the better pure passer of these quarterbacks. And so they'll look to him on second down and 18 with 24 seconds to go in the half. Coates slings it toward the end zone, incomplete. Thomas one-on-one with Latrell Pace, the strong safety.
Very well covered the entire way down the field.
And now third and 18, and Ryan Schneider will burn a timeout.
Timeout. Coco, they're second.
I think a good timeout by Schneider, just a little bit of extra time for his kids to catch their breath.
Absolutely. Yeah, because you're not going to get the ball back to do anything with it. So, yeah, let's think about it. Let's talk. Even over that play, you know, tell them again. Make sure you stay behind it. You know, it's tell them the situation again, that it's third and 18. You know, you just got to just come up and make sure of the tackle, because if they don't get a first down, the clock's going to continue to run for them to set up another play. If this is not an incomplete pass, this is going to probably be the last play of the half, because what we've seen with Raines trying to get on the ball and actually run a play. So if they don't get the first down, and that would only stop the clock momentarily. So, yeah, this is the most critical play for Coco's defense.
The fans we're showing you would indicate that it is a freezing night here in Orlando. I mean, it's cool, but it's not that cold to see people literally bundled up in full blankets.
But, you know, it has been just about 90 degrees up until, like, a couple days ago. It's felt like summer all the way to December 1st.
So out of the timeout, it's going to be third down and 18. Coco trailed 14-0, got back in it at 14-7. Coates has time to scan. He goes down, and that's going to end the half. 10 seconds to go. Raines is out of timeouts. They're not going to be able to get lined up quick enough to get this snapped.
Yeah, the ref didn't even set the ball down quick enough for him to get a snap off.
Another stand by the Coco defense, twice with Raines inside the 20. The Vikings came away with no points. And as a result, we've got a highly competitive 4A championship game. Halftime here at Camping World Stadium. Jacksonville Raines looking for back-to-back titles, leading Coco 14-7. We will step aside for the halftime break and be back for the third quarter of the 4A championship game here in downtown Orlando. Halftime of the 4A state championship game here at Camping World Stadium. Jacksonville Raines leading Coco 14-7 here as we continue with our streaming coverage from Spectrum Sports. Let's take you through some of the highlights from the first half. And the star for the Vikings was quarterback Ja'Cory Rivers.
Sure was. Only a second start, but he is something special. He could barely be brought down two or three times, and even had a touchdown brought back, but He was the star of the show. Marshall is obviously the great running back, and the combination's been tough to stop, other than penalties, which is really what stopped both teams in the first half, Austin.
Jamon Handy put Raines up 14-0. Coco with its most impressive drive on the ensuing possession. Long connection from Diego Arroyo to Willie Gaines. That got the Tigers down to the 5. And then the clever little shovel pass. Keziah Holmes able to work his way into the end zone. The Coco defense got a stop late in the second half. And that has us at a 14-7 score. You see a major difference in philosophies with the first half stats. Raines wants to run. Coco wants to throw.
Well, I think Coco wouldn't mind running a little bit better than they did. You know, they run for 170 yards a game, but yeah, they're going to have to. They're going to win this game through the air, which is how they've done it this year. Penalties on both sides, but look at what Reigns did in penalties, 10 of them over the course of the first half. But the time of possession is what I really want to look at, because in the second half, is that defensive line of Coco going to be able to hold up with Reigns pounding on them with the run game? That's really where I think we're going to see this second half open up for the Vikings.
One of those 10 penalties against Reigns wiped away a touchdown. Vikings just 2-for-4 on red zone opportunities. So the Coco defense has made a couple of stands to keep this a one-score game. A number of stars on both sides. There's Diego Arroyo, the quarterback for Coco. He's thrown for 101 yards and a touchdown. Gaines and Holmes, the two elite players at the skill positions, have made an impact. Ja'Cory Rivers, again, is the story of the first half for Reigns. This is just his second start of the season after Baron Coates led this team for most of the year, and he's been their primary attack on offense.
Yeah, he's been good. I expect them to go back to him more with Marshall as the lead blocking back. I thought that power look that they came out with for an extra offensive lineman and then Marshall lead blocking could be very, very effective, kind of devastating and demoralizing to Coco if they can't stop it early. I think we'll see a lot more of that. But, you know, on that long throw that Diego Arroyo threw to Gaines, Arroyo almost lost his knee on it. I'm just glad to see him get back up. I didn't see that originally because the big play happened down the field, but Arroyo took a shot on his leg that looked like it could have ended his season right then and there. So glad to see him up and moving, and really didn't hurt him at all.
Willie Gaines making sure his teammates are ready to roll as we start the third quarter in this rematch of last year's 4A title game. Reigns won it 13-10. Vikings scored a touchdown in the middle portion of the fourth quarter to take the lead and then held on for a three-point win. Coco had just 91 yards rushing in that game. That was more than 200 yards below their average. So the second straight year, they haven't been able to run effectively against this intimidating Reigns defense.
You know, seconds ago, Isaiah Jones, number 84, we kind of highlighted him a couple times in the first half. I think it's going to need to be Jones or Henley or their other wide receiver, Jamari Williams, that's going to have to make a big play in this game for Coco to come out and be victorious. Willie Gaines will probably make a play or two, but they're going to need one of those other guys to make a big-time play and put some points on the board.
They've shifted some of their better athletes up a little bit in this kick return. We've seen two short kicks from Matt Drayton. This one goes deep. O.J. Ross, the freshman from inside the 10. Gaines trying to lead the way as a blocker in good coverage. The Tigers will start from just outside their own 20. Two good drives from Coco. One resulted in a touchdown. The other one a fumble with the Tigers inside the 25-yard line, but it was hard to sustain a rhythm against this Reigns defense.
Yeah, it was. I mean, that first quarter, the first two possessions, because of the punt return muff that happened that gave Reigns the ball right back again, that just kept the defense out there, and the offense wasn't able to find their rhythm until later in the second quarter.
Arroyo with a fake to Holmes on the run. He lets it rip, and he's got a man wide open. Latrell Pace with a big play out of bounds inside the Reigns 30.
Coach Snyder thinking about that at halftime. What are we going to do differently? They go with a rollout after the fake. They had not shown this in the first half, and that's a deep out and up. That's why he was open. He made an outcut that got bitten on. Waited for it, and then this is why this guy's thrown for over 3,000 yards this season, puts it right on the money down the field.
That's just the sixth catch of the year for Latrell Pace, and it goes for a big gain. Arroyo back up the sideline, nearly a one-handed grab by Jamari Williams.
Williams was actually using his left hand to hold off the defender. Take a look at this. See where his left hand is? Down on the shoulder of Stewart. Could have been an offensive pass interference on that, but he almost made the one-handed grab.
Williams had the game-winning touchdown catch on third and goal from the 18 last week. Arroyo well protected. Throwing for the end zone. Gaines can't bring it in.
Well, I did not think Uriah Ratliff, the strong safety, was going to get back there to make the play at all. And Gaines says it was on him, and it is. I thought Gaines was going to come down with this for the touchdown, but you see Ratliff's there. Had to turn around backwards to try to get his hand on the ball.
So the 49-yard connection to Pace, and then back-to-back exciting incompletions from Arroyo. Now it's third and 10. Reigns moving around a lot at the snap. Arroyo with a clean pocket on target. Gaines makes the catch, and he's down close to the 10.
This is a little bit more of a downfield slant or a post route, but those are really what Coco's had success with in the passing game. Almost had one intercepted, but outside of that one, the slants and the post have been good to Coco and Arroyo. Everybody's one-on-one.
Holmes hit immediately after that handoff by Janoris Robertson.
You heard me yell, everybody's one-on-one. Did you hear that? That's why it had to be a throwing. That's why it was a throwing down. It wasn't a run. It wasn't a run for the offense. They gave it away, and that's why they lost 3 yards on it.
Duran Wiley told us Robertson is the bully of this defense. And it's a physical defensive front. Second down and 13. Robertson getting after it again. Arroyo a little bit too far for Isaiah Jones.
They've been getting kind of open on their wheel routes. There's been some space. Jones was fighting the defender off. It looked like he was trying to fight him off with his right arm, and he wasn't able to run full speed. So the ball went over his head a little bit, but had a good chance at it.
Coco just converted on third and 10. This is third and 13. Opening possession of the third quarter. Tigers trying to tie it up with a touchdown.
Look at Holmes on the left side.
Reigns rushes only three. Arroyo with a flag coming in. That ball just whizzed by Gaines, and he was immediately petitioning the officials to throw a penalty flag.
But it was they called a hold because it was early on in the route. It wasn't pass interference after the ball was released. This was way before the ball was released.
And that is not an automatic first down. It's a half the distance penalty, so they'll put the ball at the 7, and it's going to be 3rd and 6.
In the NFL, that's 5 yards, an automatic first down.
Yep.
3rd and 6, as you said, from the 7.
See what Donovan Maslin, the Reigns defensive coordinator, dials up. Vikings showing pressure. And here they come. Arroyo just gets rid of it. And well high of Isaiah Jones. So Alex Petrozello will come on to attempt a short field goal. Petrozello, 8 of 11 this year with a long of 41. Outstanding kicker. Had a good career. You see he's only missed on 2 extra points this year. But this one is no good. Petrozello not close. And Coco misses an opportunity for points.
You wonder why Arroyo may have missed that touchdown pass. He's got a split lip. It looks like he got hit in the mouth. He's got some good amount of blood on the inside of his mouth. He was showing his teammate. May have taken a good hit into the head.
We'll try to get you a shot of Diego Arroyo on the sideline. Well, for the moment, there is Arroyo.
You can see his lip. Pretty good bust.
Timeout. Coco, their first of the hat.
Coco was not aligned properly. Ryan Schneider didn't have the right personnel out there, so he burns the first timeout of this second half, and those could come very valuable if this game stays close in the fourth quarter. Reigns, the first Duval County Public School in 50 years to make it back to the state championship game. They are the only Duval County Public School to repeat, so there's been a fair amount of success for Jacksonville schools. The common theme is that all five of these back-to-back titles won by private schools. Reigns trying to become the first public school to go back-to-back.
They got a good chance right now, right in front of them. With the time of possession that they had in the first half, we're going to keep an eye on Coco's defense and see if they're just late, just a hair late to the tackle, and if they're using arm tackles, because these guys are just too tough of runners. Number seven, number one, right there in the middle of the screen, to go down with those arm tackles. And we open up again with an offsides.
Prior to the snap, encroachment, defense, 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Reigns leading by a touchdown here in the 4A title game. Brandon Marshall with a cut to the outside. Ran right into Marquise Freeman.
Freeman did a good job of holding his ground right there and making that open field tackle, basically. Makes it tough when they only have to go 5 yards for a first down.
Marshall had 139 yards and a touchdown when these teams met a year ago. So far, just 55 yards on 13 carries. It's another touch. Not able to find any space, driven to the turf by Alan Pierce.
Linebacker's had a couple chances. Haven't gotten a chance to call his name too much, but this is very nice. Helped out with his teammate Brock Collin there. Those two linebackers are going to be very critical as we talk about this defense. Those linebackers are going to have to continue to step up and help that defensive line stop this tough running game.
Pierce returning from a collarbone injury, missed more than a month. His first game back was last week. Rivers going to try to do it himself. Tyreek Sears caused him to lose his footing, and Pierce was right there to get him on the ground. What a job by this Coco defense.
And Marshall and Rivers having a chat back there. That's not exactly how that play was supposed to go down. Not sure if Marshall was supposed to make that initial block. He thought Rivers was probably going to come behind him outside. You can see everybody's kind of confused here about what was supposed to happen. But that's a great stop for Coco.
Willie Gaines near midfield to receive this punt from Deveris Thomas. End over end kick, not very good, and Coco's going to have it in plus territory. Downed at the 46-yard line.
Well, what a great start to the third quarter for Coco's defense. To get Reigns off the field, remember, Reigns, they scored 42 and 48 and gave up none the last 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. You know, regional championship and state semifinals, so they're used to going up and down the field and scoring points. We'll see if any frustration sets in for them offensively, but that was a great start for Coco's defense, giving their team back the ball at the 47-yard line.
Arroyo, 67 yards passing on that last drive. Coco got inside the 10 and missed a field goal. Another clean pocket. Hit made immediately after that catch by DeMarquez Henley. That was Nazario Jones, the nickelback.
It's good to get the other guys involved in the offense, keep everybody on their toes, keep the defense on their toes especially. Willie Gaines did look good on the slant to the top of the screen on that last play as well. Going to have some success running the ball against this kind of front.
They'll try Keziah Holmes. Not quite able to break that tackle. Nigel Allen just got enough of his legs to get Holmes down on the ground.
That's the game right here, Austin. If they're going to back out and play three to each side defensively, there's only five guys left inside. Keziah Holmes has to step out of that and make a big-time play in this state championship game. Now they've got six in the box, so it's a different look.
Got Eric Horn lined up as a rush end. They bring pressure. Coco picks it up, and it's a completion for a first down. Isaiah Jones inside the 10. It'll be first and goal.
This is a good little timing route. People call it a lot of different things. He's right at the top of the screen. He goes out and then turns around, spins back, and comes back inside. They're in man-to-man, beats his man, and gets down close to the 8-yard line.
Second possession of the third quarter for Coco. Both of them have gone inside the 10. And the Tigers find a way to punch it in.
We talked about Jones Henley. Now Jamari Williams, number 11, is going to need to make a big play as well to get his name on the board.
Holmes spins his way inside the 5 with Robertson trying to rip that football out of there. Approaching the midway point of the third quarter, and a big moment in this 4A championship game.
They ran that inside shovel pass from the 4-yard line to score in the first half. This looks like this is a similar setup. I doubt they're going to run the same play, but this is a formation that they ran it out of last time.
They'll hand it to Gaines with Holmes as the lead blocker. He is not able to set the edge, and Gaines is run out of bounds by Ratliff.
Lost a yard on the run.
And Holmes is down back behind the play. And based on the way the coach is checking him out, that looks to be a cramp.
Water break.
5:44 to go as the officials will take the mandatory water break to allow Keziah Holmes to get some treatment. John Wilkinson set the standard for excellence in this program. Tigers virtually no success in the postseason before Wilkinson arrived, and he built them into a state power. Averaged more than 10 wins per season over a 13-year stretch. And Ryan Schneider, who has won a state championship as a coordinator, in fact, he's won 3 of them, now trying to lead the Tigers to the top in his first season as the head coach.
That's pretty amazing in and of itself for Coach Schneider to be at 3 different schools, have their state championships at the other two, and be here already in his first year. That's amazing. But previous coach to 143 wins isn't the biggest number of all time, but as you said, you only play 10 games a year, and he had more than 10 wins average per season. So, I mean, that's just amazing.
Ryan Schneider threw for more than 10,000 yards in his career as a quarterback for UCF. Here he's hoping Diego Arroyo can throw for 5. Third down and goal. Reigns brings pressure. Arroyo's pass bobbled at the goal line. Jamari Williams couldn't hang on.
Going to go for it, don't you think, Austin, here instead of kicking a field goal? Here comes the field goal team. I thought they might go for it here. I also thought they were going to throw to the other side of the field here instead of into the short side. Good defensive stop by James Tarver Jr. The senior gets his name on the board on an important play.
A 22-yard field goal attempt for Petrozello just missed from a similar distance. This one is right down the middle. 9th field goal of the year for senior Alex Petrozello. And he makes it a 4-point game with 5.5 minutes to go here in the third.
That's the safe call to put the points on the board, but I just thought they might go for it there. But after the missed field goal last time, you know, it's from the 4-yard line, come up with your best 2-point play type play and go for it. And if you don't get it, you leave the team at the 4-yard line. And, you know, they just had a great stop on defense. they do kick the field goal, so it's a four-point game. We'll see what happens. I mean, defense comes out and goes three and out again, gives their offense decent field position. They've been making it happen in the open field, but the red zone, those last 5 yards have been hard to finish for Coco.
Rain's band enjoying a Thursday night here at Camping World Stadium, hoping their Vikings can win a second consecutive title. And Coco trying to return to the top. State champion in 2016, state runner-up a year ago. 14-7 at the half. Coco has twice been inside the 10-yard line here in the third quarter, and they've come away with a total of 3 points. Rain's holding on to a 14-10 lead. Here's Thomas on the return. Stumbles as he cuts it to the outside and steps out of bounds at the 35. As Jeff mentioned, a flag behind the play.
Jordan return, blocking the back on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty. Also, we have a sideline warning on Coco. They're first.
Well, the pretty nice return wiped out and will put them deep in their own end, so it does give Coco that opportunity to try to get them a stop and get the ball back at midfield. See if Reigns can build some momentum back up with their offense. They went three and out their first opportunity, and they were a little mixed up. You know, the quarterback and running back were on different pages, and we'll see if they got that figured out.
Thomas stepped out of bounds at the 35. They put the ball back at the 9. A costly penalty. And again, Reigns not organized. Matt Drayton had to run off the field late before the snap. A run with Marshall. He does a good job tiptoeing along that near sideline. Picked up an extra 3 or 4 yards. It's going to go as a gain of 6. Now Coco's best lineman is down. That's Richie Leonard, who is the starting left tackle. He's also seen a lot of action tonight on the interior of the defensive line. The training staff out to look at the 6'4", 285-pound junior. He is the only junior captain on this team and is already committed to the University of Kentucky.
Well, both legs went up like the cramp. They got two trainers working on both legs. Not quite ready to go.
Now you hope it's not anything that will keep Leonard out of the lineup.
Well, we still have those mandatory water breaks all the way here in December. You know, in Florida, we get them because it's so hot and humid, but you think that by the time this cool weather would come around, you wouldn't need it. But, hey, we've got linemen going down and running backs going down with cramps.
So as they continue to work on Richie Leonard, Mandarin this year, or Reigns rather, lost their season opener against Jacksonville Lee. Second straight year they've lost that game, and Lee got to the 7A region final. And then they had a stretch where they played 6 straight games on the road against teams like Mandarin, Lincoln, Oakleaf, all teams that were in the playoffs. They won all 6 of those, and as you see Leonard get help to the sideline, that was the moment at which Duran Wiley knew, okay, if we can stay healthy and stay motivated, our group's got a good chance to get back to Camping World and play for another title.
Absolutely. Now, as Leonard, you know, limps off the field, even more importantly than him playing on defense, because they do have some other defensive linemen, but he's a starting offensive tackle, and that's the bigger concern for Coach Snyder on the other sideline.
Yeah, Leonard out means Zachary Gay will get all the reps at the other defensive tackle spot. 6 foot, 290-pound sophomore. Second down and 4. Marshall with back-to-back carries. This one a negative carry. No room for Marshall so far here in the second half. That was A.J. Williams sophomore linebacker.
I want to find out what Coco did in the locker room. Did they eat orange slices or Gatorade? What did they do there? Because they have come out big time in this second half.
Dejavon White made that play, just drove the offensive lineman back 4 yards. And Williams ultimately gets credit for the tackle. Three and out for Reigns on their last possession. Need to convert here to avoid going three and out again. Rivers drops to throw for it, hoisting it toward the sideline, intercepted. That's Jamari Williams returning it inside the 10-yard line for Coco.
And a flag does come out on the sideline right where the ball went out of bounds. I was looking for Jamari Williams to make a big play on offense. He comes through on defense. This is an easy interception for him from the safety position. The ball floats on the corner route. It was not going to be complete either way, but Williams makes the easy interception and sets his team up in great field position. Late hit out of bounds, I think.
There's another flag that is on the Coco sideline.
Personal foul. On the offense, on the return. We also have the second sideline warning on Coco. That's a 5-yard penalty. We penalize both. It's going to happen this.
It's going to end up being more of a penalty for the sideline warning than it is going to be for the personal foul, because they'll go half the distance and then go 5 yards back.
And the full penalty back, yeah.
That's the 29th takeaway of the year for this Coco defense, and it keeps the streak alive. They've had at least one in every game this season.
Well, ultimately only moves the ball back about 1 to 2 yards from where it went out of bounds originally. But what a turn of events for Reigns' offense to just completely die out here to start the third quarter. Coco's defensive line to come through big time.
Correction. We had sideline interference, which is unsportsmanlike, on Coco. So that'd be a 15-yard penalty.
Yeah, it's going to go back another 10 then to the 18-yard line. Good to see Richie Leonard back in at left tackle. Looks like he's walking gingerly on his right. Oh, he's actually going to go back off the field. He's limping pretty badly on his right leg that's got the brace on it. I think it's just from the cramps. Now he actually turns around and comes back in. Looked like he was going to go out there for a minute. We'll see if he can stay in here. It's not easy to do. When you're cramped, you cannot play football.
And Leonard is lined up across from Janoris Robertson. Here's Keziah Holmes. Gets it inside the 10. Takes a horde of Vikings defenders to bring him down. Near a first down at the 8-yard line.
And that looked very similar to the play just last series, where if he was able to step out of the tackle, it was going to be a pretty big play. And this time he does step out of it and picks up a first down. Makes a goal to go.
All three possessions in the third quarter for Coco have gone inside the Reigns 10-yard line. But the Tigers have yet to score a touchdown. And motion gains. Here's Holmes. Nice crease created by that offensive line. And Holmes goes head over heels at the 3.
You know, even though at halftime I was talking about the time of possession was so much in Reigns' favor that it was going to be tough on Coco and their defense, and it looks the exact opposite. The offense can't get going, and the defense is much bigger holes for Holmes to run through here to open up this third quarter.
Second down and goal. Holmes again gets close to the 1.
Four down territory for you, Austin?
I think, barring a penalty, I think so.
Yeah, I'm not going to kick another field goal and be down 1 point.
Reigns brings in another big body, Jamon Goodwine, at that nose guard position. Third and goal. Holmes again, and he fumbles again, recovered by Reigns. Or did Richie Leonard get it back? They'll say now that Leonard ends up recovering it for Coco.
Here comes the field goal team. Wow, can you believe that he put the ball on the ground again? And you see Richie Leonard was just in the right place at the right time. What a tackle. Oh, my goodness. He
Raven
was blocking down.
Raven Tribune had it for Reigns, and Leonard ends up knocking it free.
Wow.
So the Tigers get a chance for a field goal on what could have been disaster. 24-yard kick for Petrozello. It's blocked. The Reigns defense comes up with a huge stand, and Coco is denied points again.
Kind of an unbelievable turn of events. Easily blocked. They've got to get that down and back up a lot quicker than that. I'll say this though, Austin, I do think that that was the play of the game for Coco in a positive way for Richie Leonard, making that stop, because I think he could have scooped and scored from 90 plus yards away. So they don't get the field goal, but they don't give up a touchdown, a demoralizing touchdown. So I give play of the game to Richie Leonard so far.
James Tarver Jr. was the player who blocked it. Still tough sledding for Brandon Marshall. Well, Coco has owned this third quarter. They've been inside the Reigns 10-yard line three times, but they have only 3 points.
That's it. Inside that five, they haven't been able to get it done. They need to spread the ball back out and play their regular offense for those last 5 yards, 15 yards of the field with the end zone.
Rivers, nowhere to go. De'Javon White takes him down in the backfield yet again.
This is a defensive football game. Didn't expect it as much, but it is turning into just two defenses that are just showing up. How about this guy? White is just special. Sophomore. And I'm telling you what, you said he wasn't getting recruited yet because he's 5'10". He will become a nose guard, and he will become a very highly recruited football player. He's not going to get recruited on the outside at 5'10", but move inside, be a nose-type guard, and he is going to get big-time offers. He's something special.
The last time Rivers threw it, it was an interception. He heaves it up. Catch is made by Thomas, but he is hit immediately. Jaquez Hicks, sophomore safety, with a tackle. And yet again, this Coco defense forces Reigns into a three and out.
Hey, White was a millisecond from getting another sack right here. Watch him come in here. Look at that speed he's got. He's becoming Rivers' worst nightmare.
And Thomas standing just outside the goal line to punt it away to Gaines.
Gaines at the 40-yard line, inside the 40. Not giving him any respect.
Probably the best punt of the night from Thomas. Gaines tells everybody to get away, and it takes about a 20-yard roll into Coco territory.
Yeah, my heart almost stopped a second. I thought Gaines was going to try to make a play on that. He was very wise not to, and it did cost the team 15 yards, but there was nothing he could do about it. Coming up on that was going to be tough to try to get the fair catch. So cost him a few yards, but didn't make a big mistake in trying to pick that up again.
1 second remains in this third quarter. Reigns led 14-7 at the half. They've done nothing offensively, but their defense has made some big stops with Coco in position to score a touchdown. Just 1 yard this quarter for Reigns. Arroyo taking a shot, some contact with the defenders. Gaines wanted a flag, none coming against James Tarver Jr.
I think it's a good call. I think it was incidental contact. The feet got tripped up. I like the throw and I like the call. I'd go right back to it and do it again, or throw the comeback. Don't just sling it up in the air. Throw the comeback and it'll be wide open. But I think it was incidental contact.
End of the third quarter here at Camping World Stadium. We head to the final 12 minutes.
That's the end of the third
quarter.
A tight
game between Reigns and Coco with the 4A championship hanging in the balance. remains just 1 yard of offense in that third quarter, but the Vikings holding on to a 14-10 lead as we start the fourth. One more look at that last play of the third quarter with Arroyo trying to hit Willie Gaines.
Just threw it up from the very beginning. Actually, in high school football, you got to call that. He just ran, put his hand right in his chest, and knocked him down. You do have to call
prior
that.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense. 5 yard penalty, repeat, second down.
And if you're watching that replay thinking that the ball was uncatchable, that rule doesn't apply in high school football. It does in college and the NFL, but whether or not a ball is catchable is not a part of whether you
that
call pass interference as an
easily
official.
Catchable for Gaines. Would have been easily catchable for Gaines. No, I didn't realize he actually was still forward, put his hand in his chest and knocked him down. I thought they were turned and were running and then just got their feet caught up. So that was a missed call for the referees.
Second and 15. Went to heavy traffic. That throw by Arroyo. Jamari Williams tightly covered by Tarver.
Slants have been their go-to, but Reigns has done a pretty darn good job of covering them.
Well, this changed quickly for Coco. Looked like they might get the ball in plus territory. Gaines allowed the punt to drop and end up rolling to the 40, and now it is third and 15.
Giving him a different look here.
Arroyo able to step up. Down the middle, the catch is made by Isaiah Jones.
One-handed Austin Lyon. He just reached out and snagged this thing. He thought he was a basketball player. This kid is a wide receiver. Look at that snag.
Ooh. What an effort by Isaiah Jones, and it comes on third and 15.
A number of big plays for him.
Moves it to the Reigns 31. Holmes brought down by Nigel Allen, the emotional leader and captain of this Reigns defense.
Well, Holmes has to take care of the football. That's beyond going for a big run. Is taking care of the football. You think about this game at 14-10. Holmes has put the ball on the ground twice, and Gaines put the ball on the ground to start the game. So they've had a lot of big time mistakes for a state championship game, and they're down four. That's pretty impressive.
Empty backfield for Arroyo. He's going to run, and nowhere to go. Jaron Wilson.
6'2", 220 junior. He's got six sacks on the year. Another third long and long.
And likely two downs to get it. Reigns has not been able to get to Arroyo on third down. The offensive line has done a great job with protection. They rush three. Arroyo from the pocket throws, nearly intercepted, and they will say it is intercepted. Uriah Ratliff.
The referees don't get to look at replays. If this ball stays off the ground, I would be very, very surprised. Let's take a look. This is way out in front. Let's see. That is not a...
Not even close.
Interception, no sir. When it hits the ground and spins in your hands like that, that is not a catch. I didn't think it was from our distance. We're a long ways away from the field, but didn't think it was from our distance. Referee should have been able to see that pretty easily.
So the call goes against Coco. An interception for Ratliff. And the Vikings offense back out there. De'Javon White continues to wreak havoc.
Did you say Reggie White?
Looks like Reggie White.
This guy's unbelievable. He's unblockable. Look at it. Well, actually, they didn't even try to block him. They were setting up like a screen pass. But that doesn't take anything away from him. He was on the quarterback last series, First play of this series. He's been outrageous tonight.
9 tackles from his defensive tackle position. 4 of them for loss. 2nd and 17. Maybe Coco's defense can get a score. Rivers hoisting it up the sideline. The Coco defender fell down. And Jamari Williams and Gaines back there as well.
Jamari Williams should have had an interception. He's a wide receiver. He should have caught this ball over his head very easily. He misjudged it. That was an opportunity right there to turn it back around and maybe even get a return on it. He threw that ball up like a punt.
Well, 3rd down and 17. You wonder if maybe Duran Wiley considers going to Barron Coates, and now here Coates is. Tough spot to come in. 3rd and 17. Trying to set up a screen. It's complete to Marshall. And he gets barely outside the 10 before Sears drives him down.
That is a difficult situation to come in as a quarterback off the sideline. You may not be that cold. You know, you warmed up at halftime, but to come in that situation, you didn't ask him to do that much on the screen pass, but still very difficult situation to be thrown into both in the first half and here in the fourth quarter. Coco with going to get great field position once again. If they don't get a penalty or anything, they should get very good field position.
Can Gaines catch this punt from Thomas? Does catch it and go out of bounds at the 38. Always some high-profile recruits on this Coco roster. Tigers never have the depth of some of the other elite small school programs, but the first 22 they put on the field are always among the best in the state. Willie Gaines committed to Toledo. It's the player Ryan Schneider said is the best high school player he's ever been around. Offers for Keziah Holmes include Florida and Miami. Richie Leonard, who's battled all night in the trenches at both offensive and defensive line, committed to Kentucky. And Raisheen Lynn suffered a broken collarbone. He was one of their top players, both at wide receiver and in the secondary, has missed this entire postseason run.
We haven't seen a two-back formation, Austin, from Coco yet. Delay coming out. We haven't seen that formation.
Delay
getting set up.
On the offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
I thought they were going to go more to a 5-wide receiver full-time package. They come out with 3 wide receivers and 2 running backs. Give them a little different look, but they've been in first and 15 way too many times tonight.
22 combined accepted penalties between the teams. Here's freshman O.J. Ross. Gets to the 40-yard line. Coming up on 8 minutes to go in this 4A championship game. Reigns has done nothing offensively against Coco in the second half. But the Vikings defense has kept them in the lead. Arroyo looked at Holmes. Taking a deep shot, one-on-one for Gaines, nearly intercepted. Tarver Jr. there, and a flag comes in late.
I think he pulled on him to come around as he went
pass
to the post.
Pass interference on the defense, 15-yard penalty.
Either right before result of the penalty, the jump.
It'll be a first down.
Or as he moved to the post, let's see if we can pick it up here. It's going to be late. It's going to be late here at the bottom part of the screen. Not very much that we saw. All that ticky-tack.
Instead of 3rd and 12, it is 1st and 10 for Coco at the 25. They go speed sweep with Gaines. Lost his footing as he cut up field. It's funny, as the game unfolds, you tend to forget about all the calls that determine the outcome, but Reigns gets a huge break with an interception call when clearly the ball hit the ground. Maybe it wasn't pass interference on Tarver. Things often end up evening out.
Agreed.
Can Gaines make a big play? Had a 40-plus yard reception that led to a touchdown in the first half. Arroyo looking toward Gaines. That's going to be ruled incomplete. Isaiah Jones could not get a foot down in bounds. Another third and long. Cocos found themselves in these types of situations a lot.
Been impressed with number 84 tonight. Lots of big plays, and for a kid that had to be talked into playing by the coach, he's had a great game in a state championship.
Coco 5 for 12 on third down. Rains brings pressure. Picked up. That pass is incomplete.
I thought that one looked more like an interception than the last one.
And once again, it was Ratliff.
Not a good throw. This is well covered. Couldn't tell what was happening with the ball when it went behind him, if it was actually rolling around on the ground or not. It hits the ground. I think it hits the ground at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But that was definitely not a good throw.
So Coco going to go for it here on 4th and 10. Arroyo looking toward the sideline to see what Ryan Schneider wants. Arroyo has pressure. Flag is thrown. Arroyo goes down. Is the penalty going to be for holding? Or was there a face mask?
I thought I saw a face mask by the side judge.
5 yard incidental face mask on the defense. Added to the end of the run. Still 4th down.
That's actually a 15-yard. That should have been a 15-yarder. You took the quarterback and completely changed the play because of it. Should have been a 15-yard penalty.
So from 4th and 10, it's going to be 4th and 5. And this is within the range of Alex Petrozello. He's got a long of 41 this year, but Ryan Schneider keeps the offense out there.
Oh, yeah, there's no choice on that. Have to keep the offense out there.
And they're going to call a timeout.
Timeout. Coco.
It's the right time to take that second timeout. We talked about that one they took early. Might cost them, but this is too critical of a time. Got to get the right play call in, because this is the time to convert and take the lead.
Ryan Schneider wasn't going to win the argument, but he was making the same point that you made. Quarterback's face mask was grabbed and twisted around, changing the play. Should have been 15 instead of 5. That's his position.
Yep.
And instead, he'll have to put together a play call here. 4th down and 5. What are you looking for from Coco?
I think they should use motion and create some sort of a mix-up for the defense. Haven't used it much. Use their running back. You know, they've got a good running back. Get them out of the backfield and make their defensive backs make a choice and make a mistake and leave somebody wide open. I don't think he's been doing that. Not that much, not blocking anybody. He's getting pressure. They're getting pressure with the front 3 or 4 without using the back to help block. So get him out in the pattern and make them cover him.
Rains brought pressure on 4th and 10. Only got 2 linemen with their hands down here on 4th and 5. They rush 3. Arroyo's pass caught, and that's going to be a 1st down. Willie Gaines with the sure-handed catch at the 14.
You know what? It's a great call because he's been going deep. He is a deep threat. So just catch and release. Get rid of it. Don't put your quarterback where he has to get a hit or make a play. And you just get that quick 5 yards, and now you got 1st down again.
Rains brings a run blitz, and Nigel Allen cuts down Holmes in the backfield. 1 yard loss.
Yeah, I thought, you know, earlier they went to 5 wide receivers, and I thought they were going to stay in it the rest of the game because they were seeing success. They had open receivers. I don't think they're going to run against Rain's defense very much anymore. I'd be using 4 and 5 receivers on every single play.
Arroyo with the pocket starting to collapse. A lot of contact on the route. And Williams makes a fantastic catch.
Now, this is, in my opinion, this is pass interference. He's in front of him. He makes a great play. He's out in front, but he's actually interfering with the receiver before the ball comes. Let's take a look together. It's going to come into our screen at the top. See where he's at. Actually, I think he stepped in front. Tarver has had a lot of good plays tonight. He got the pass interference moments ago, but he's made a number of good plays.
Third and three, and it's batted down. Fourth and three for Coco with 5:18 to go, and Ryan Schneider is sending out the field goal team.
Talk about having confidence in your defense. And he should, based on what they've done so far in the second half, but I don't know how you kick a field goal and then go down 14-13 with 5 minutes left. Very tough.
Petrozello 1 for 3, missed one, had another blocked. All of them from short range. This one is good. Just slips it through that right upright. So for the fourth time in the second half, Coco gets inside the 10-yard line. They've got two field goals to show for it. Alex Petrozello makes it a one-point game, 14-13. As we take a look at the game summary, Arroyo has thrown for 251 and a score. Rivers and Marshall shut down in the second half.
You said that right. They were shut down with emphasis. I mean, this has been just unbelievable for me to see Coco come back and be so dominant defensively, and Reigns to be almost inept on offense for this whole second half when they were really, really strong, and Rivers was so good in that first half. And now, is it Coach in just on a long distance pass, or is he going to be in for a little bit more time here in the last 5 minutes? Now, you know, Coach Schneider has a lot of confidence. He's going to shut down Reigns on offense one more time and kick a field goal to win this football game and get out of here with his fourth state title, personal state titles. But man, that took a lot of guts to do.
Petrozello's kick taken by Thomas at the 15. Nowhere to go on that return. So the Reigns offense, which had its way with Coco in the first half on the ground, has negative 3 yards in the second half.
It's hard to believe. The way Rivers was just getting out of the pocket and moving around. I mean, I all due respect, all respect to Coco's defensive line. They have come out, and especially White, number 44, with his knee on the ground right there. He's been unbelievable.
It's Baron Coates that's out there for this series. First time tonight he started a series. A run by Marshall, and once again, Coco's there. Sears and Holland combine on the stop, and there is nowhere to run for this Reigns offense. But Coco only has one timeout, so if Reigns can get a couple of first downs, they would ice the game away.
That's why it was scared me to kick the field goal. But you said Sears and Holland on the tackle, but it was Javon White that stopped that play in the backfield and made him redirect. That's why they were able to team up and get that tackle behind the line of scrimmage.
4.5 to go, second down and 11 for the Vikings. Coates, well protected up the sideline. He's got Marshall inside the 35. Coco rallying to try and get Marshall on the ground. He breaks a tackle. Marshall, touchdown, Reigns.
Devastating to Coco. An unbelievable play to their running back down the field. They bring in the passer. Coach comes in and puts a dime on Marshall, who does all kinds of special things here to get the ball into the end zone.
Touchdown is good, but we have a sideline warning on Reigns. They're first.
Now, Austin, the one thing, because of the field goal, it's probably going to be an 8-point lead. So there'll still be one score and a 2-point conversion from tying this game up.
An unbelievable effort by Marshall. The all-time leading rusher in Reigns football history. And the biggest play of his career is a pass catch.
Well, they had done nothing on offense. So We mentioned the quarterbacks last week with Alabama, and going back a year before that, and the passer came in at halftime and led Alabama to the national title. The passer comes in a critical situation and makes it pay off. 22nd touchdown pass of the season for Baron Coates. Stayed in there, kept his mind right, and puts a strike on his best receiver out there.
A heavy advantage. Marshall matched up with Brock Holland.
Holland's going to be kicking himself for a long time that he didn't at least tackle Brandon Marshall right there when he caught the ball.
Marshall with over 4,000 yards in his career. Had a solid first half on the ground tonight, but the biggest play of the game is that 74-yard catch and run. And Reigns now with an 8-point lead and 4:04 to go. The signature moment in Brandon Marshall's career. And is that enough to deliver back-to-back championships for the Vikings? Freshman O.J. Ross gets it back to Keziah Holmes, a dangerous play on that return, and Holmes took a pretty big shot as he crossed the 20.
That was dangerous, but I thought I saw a hole that he was going to jump through, and instead he got a really big hit.
A lot more energy now on that Reigns sideline. Brian Dawkins helping to lead the cheers.
He was a pretty good emotional leader during his Hall of Fame
career. I would say so. Let's see what Diego Arroyo and this Coco offense can do. They need a touchdown and a 2-point conversion to tie it. And with one timeout, probably four down territory the rest of the game, Arroyo checks it down. Holmes makes the catch and a gain of 3.
I was saying they need to use Holmes out there as a receiver. They did bring him out of the backfield. He was their primary guy. That's really what they wanted to do, just a little 2-yard out route, and that's about what they picked up.
Well, plenty of time given how well this Coco offense has moved it in the second half. They just haven't been able to punch it in. Gaines on the slant route incomplete. Jarius Stewart there with him stride for stride, and it is 3rd and 7.
Quarterback didn't give him a chance on that one. I think he thought he had something going if that ball was on target. Well, if Coco is unsuccessful in this comeback bid, they'll know that they had their opportunities. They made some big mistakes in a championship game.
Arroyo on target. Williams out of bounds with a first down at the 36.
And a nice pitch and catch, just like that. Catch it, throw the quick out route, pick up the first down, stop the clock, all of the above.
Decision making and timing have been the strengths for Arroyo during this playoff run. They've been on display here in the second half. Let's this one go. No one there for Coco, and it's intercepted. Trayvon Hobbs on the return for the Vikings. He wants a pick 6, and he's going to get it.
Gaines ran the quick slant, and Arroyo just threw it up. I don't think this was going to be a very good pass, even if he went on a go route. You can see how long the ball hangs up and how easily the defender is just waiting for it. See, that wouldn't have been outside wide enough if Gaines would have run a go route, but he ran a slant, so it made it look all the worse. And then big hits all around. You see Brandon Jones trying to come back. He gets clipped by his own player. Wow, what a turnaround of a football game.
Two huge plays for Reigns on their sideline. The catch and run by Marshall and the pick six for Trayvon Hobbs. And the junior with his fifth pick of the year has put an exclamation point on this 4A title game for the Vikings. What a moment for Trayvon Hobbs.
Sealed the deal. That Brandon Marshall touchdown was a backbreaker, but that one put the nail in the coffin.
PAT no good from Nigel Smith, so it stays a 14-point game. Take you back to the interception.
You know, they had one other time where they miscommunicated on the slant go route in the third quarter. That one again, I don't think that was going to get out to a gains like you wanted it to.
Well, the Reigns defense, we talked a lot about the Coco defense in the second half, and certainly deservedly so until the touchdown pass to Marshall. But this Reigns defense, Coco inside the 10-yard line four times, a total of 6 points, and then the pick six by Hobbs.
That's it. That's what I was saying. They had their chances. That's what they're going to really take this loss hard, you know, because they had their chances. And they did not play their best football in the biggest game.
Still 3 minutes to go. If Coco can somehow get a big play for a touchdown, maybe an onside kick. Holmes from the 20. The ball comes out at the end of the return. Pretty sure Holmes was down, but there's been no signal from the officials. Stay Coco ball. So the Tigers need a quick score and then they need an onside kick to have any hope.
Yeah, I think they need to use Holmes not in the backfield anymore, but he looks like he's been cramping up or having a little bit of trouble with his legs. He does not look like he's full go. But they've got to press the secondary by getting that fifth receiver in the package.
Out route incomplete and a big hit delivered by Bonsall.
Good.
And that dance is going to draw a 15-yard penalty.
15 yards.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct on the defense. 15-yard penalty. Result of the penalty.
Isaiah
first
Jones
down.
Was just moments ago laying on the ground after the interception return. It took him a long time to get off the field with help. And he just took that big hit on that play.
And Duran Wiley is delivering a strong message to Javon Bonsall over there on the Reigns sideline. 15 yards moves it into Vikings territory. Holmes. Reigns right now is just the more aggressive physical team.
Yes, and honestly, there's not time for any play that looks like that. There's no time for run plays anymore. They either have to throw a completion that moves the ball down the field or stops the clock on an incompletion. Here they go to their five wide receiver package. I should have gone to this earlier.
Arroyo off target, trying to find Gaines. Sitting down in front of Eric Horn. What a moment for that young man, Baron Coates. Started the first 12 games of the year for this team. Was sent to the bench last week in favor of Ja'Cory Rivers. Rivers gets the start tonight, but when his team needed a spark, he was there to deliver. Three defensive linemen converge on Arroyo. It's going to be fourth down and long for Coco. And the last hope for the Tigers is a conversion here as we go under 2 minutes.
I'll tell you what, on that particular play, it didn't matter how much time Arroyo would have had to throw. They covered it so well that the route actually ran into the coverage. So they covered it themselves up. So that was not going to be a good play. Here it is, fourth down and long.
Only two rushers for Reigns down the middle. It's intercepted. Eric Horn dropping into coverage. Interceptions on back-to-back possessions for the Reigns defense. And the celebration is underway for the boys from Duval County.
We didn't call Eric Horn's name a lot tonight, but he's a great player, senior, 6'1", 210. He's going to Iowa State. That was going to be a tough conversion.
It's Richie Leonard once again needing assistance from the training staff. Coco Jr. offensive lineman.
I tell you what, Richie Leonard is going to go down in defeat tonight, but that kid is really impressive. He's only a junior, but on the interception return, he was almost down there to make the tackle. Just now, he made the tackle on Eric Horn. This guy, even though things hadn't gone well, certain plays, he was out there. Remember, he was the one that actually made the fumble recovery at the 8-yard line or whatever it was inside there. This guy's made some unbelievable plays, both offensively and defensively, and you can see why he's having trouble with the cramping because he's been everywhere.
Playing a lot more tonight than he normally would. Ryan Schneider was so concerned about how his team would hold up in the trenches on the offensive and defensive lines. And so Leonard, as a result, seeing a lot more time on the defensive line, and the shirts have been printed.
Say the first public school to do that.
A lot of private schools have gone back to back in the Jacksonville area, but the only public school from Duval County to win a state championship is about to earn a second title. And what a moment it is for Baron Coates to be out there under center and take the final couple snaps for Reigns. There's the bath for Duran Wiley and his assistants. Donovan Maslin, the defensive coordinator.
Well deserved.
He just said how sweet it is. One or two more snaps for the Vikings. Final score not going to be indicative of how close this game was.
No, it was a great football game and really a defensive battle, but just the big turnovers and the opportunities that went by the wayside for Coco. But Reigns, they deserve. They played a great first half, really dominant first half, and then made the huge, humongous plays in the second half to put the game away.
The Vikings have added themselves to that illustrious list. Duran Wiley about to be given one of those back-to-back shirts.
He's going to need it. Dry off and warm up a little bit.
There's the final snap from Baron Coates. He comes off the bench in the fourth quarter and throws a 74-yard touchdown pass to Brandon Marshall to help separate the Reigns Vikings from the Coco Tigers. Here is the moment for Duran Wiley. A couple of different coolers. A class program. Duran Wiley has gotten Reigns to the point where the expectation is to win titles. We first covered Reigns here back in 2015 when Wiley said the players were happy to be here. They thought getting here was a significant accomplishment. It was okay that they didn't win the championship. They no longer have that feeling. The expectation is to get here and win. And Duran Wiley, a proud Reigns alum, can celebrate more history for his program, and certainly a lot to be proud of for Coco's first-year head coach, Ryan Schneider.
No doubt, both sides. I mean, I'm sure Coach Schneider is going to, you know, really think about a lot of things that happened tonight and just the opportunities that went by. But to get both these teams back here into the state final, especially him as his first year, and then Reigns, what, three out of the last four have been here and now go to back-to-back, very, very impressive.
A lot of impactful seniors, both quarterbacks who played tonight, Rivers and Coates, Brandon Marshall, the all-time leading rusher for Reigns, Thomas, Drayton, Holloman, Handy, all the receivers, and so many key members of that defense playing their final high school game, and a moment they will never forget. And for Coco, the quarterback, Arroyo, just a sophomore. Keziah Holmes is a junior. A lot of promising guys on defense, especially Dejavon White, just a sophomore. An expectation that this young Coco team has a good chance to be in this position again.
No doubt about it. They sling the ball around. They got a lot of good talent out there, so they'll be back. They'll be very close to getting back next year.
It'll be silver medals for Richie Leonard, Diego Arroyo, and the Coco Tigers as the Reigns Vikings win it by the final score of 27-13. We invite you to stay with us. We will have the medals ceremony here from Camping World Stadium. So stay with us on the stream for that if you're a fan of either of these teams. A reminder, we've got six more championship games coming here from Camping World Stadium over the next couple of days. It'll be a busy time for our crew and some great championship action. So for Jeff Carlson and our entire Spectrum Sports crew, Austin Lyons saying good night from Camping World Stadium. Stay with us. Medal ceremony coming up for the 4A championship game.
for the award ceremony, presenting the team trophies on behalf of the Florida High School Athletic Association are Doug Dodd, FHSAA Board of Directors, and George Tommen, Executive Director of the FHSAA. First, we recognize the 2018 Class 4A State Runners-Up Team, the Cocoa Tigers. Mr. Dodd and Mr. Tommen will now present the state runner-up trophy to head coach Ryan Snyder and his captains, Alan Pierce, Willie Gaines, Brock Holland, and Alex Petrozello. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2018 Class 4A State Runners-Up, the Cocoa Tigers. And now, ladies and gentlemen, join us as we honor the 2018 Class 4A State Champion Team, the Rains Vikings. Mr. Dodd and Mr. Tommen will present the state championship trophy to head coach Duran Wiley and his captains, Brandon Marshall, Mac Drayton, Javon Bonsell, and Nigel Allen. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2018 Class 4A state champions from Jacksonville, the Rains Vikings.
Number one.
One, two, three.